Don't worry, this isn't the plot of The Last of Us. I know the fungi there are creepy, and thanks to the new TV series it has really shaken the zombie apocalypse standards. So long, viruses! But this time, I will tell you a bit about some nicer fungi. The ones that could, in the future, help humanity. As they did a lot of times before, like with penicillin for example. But how did we get from Chernobyl disaster to reducing radiation exposure effects in astronauts thanks to the fungi? Today we will speak of something that may sound like out of the planet. Since we discovered ionizing radiation, we thought that it was basically destructive or at best disruptive, having in mind humans or other living organisms, that is. But there were voices questioning the assumption. After all, life does not tolerate void. There were theories that there should be some organisms living off or at least using it for their own benefits. That theory was called radiosynthesis. Its creator, Russian microbiologist Kuznetsov, described it as a metabolism of ionizing radiation. If it brings memories of another process, photosynthesis, that's good. Known to you probably thanks to biology class in primary school, photosynthesis is a process that could be roughly explained as the one which allows them to convert light energy into chemical energy. Thus, it's one of the basic ones to plants, which help them proliferate and grow. Radiosynthesis was suspected to work almost exactly the same way, but there were no evidence. In 1950s, when the theory was first introduced publicly, no known organisms could perform it. That changed thanks to one of the most destructive human-made disasters. Yes, the Chernobyl event. In years following it, researchers always found the place very interesting. Its tragic history was, of course, one thing, but what happened was already done, so at least they could use the outcome for some kind of benefit to the science. Thanks to that interest, in 1990s they discovered hundreds of fungi that were apparently feeding themselves with radiation. They were found in close proximity to the reactor, on the walls of the reactor room and in the contaminated soil. The astonishing thing was pretty much exactly what you could expect. How the hell did those fungi endure in such an unfriendly environment? Well, to be honest, we know quite a lot of extremophiles, so organisms that basically don't mind or even prefer extreme environments, such as inside of the volcanoes. But some researchers propose that maybe we should look at those fungi in a different way. Not trying to understand how it grew despite the radiation, but using the radiation. There was little life there which fungi could proliferate on, so scientists had a hard time telling how exactly did they grow if their usual menu wasn't available. They were also found in other areas, exposed for example to very intense ultraviolet radiation. So, as you see, there was something fishy going on there. Again, the appearance of radiosynthesis was only one of the explanations. Probable, no doubt, but scientists still needed hard proof. But there was a growing interest in finding that proof, or at least learning that radiosynthesis is still only a theory, in the worst case scenario. And the Americans entered the chat. A team of researchers from the Albert Einstein College of Medicine of Yeshiva University in New York began their tests, experimenting with those organisms. They exposed melanized fungi to radiation and found out that it actually boosted the growth of the fungi, 3 times faster than normal. That melanin, crucial to this whole equation, increased the fungi metabolic reactions. This isn't something very odd. Melanin has been referred to as fungal armor, acting as a protection agent for microorganisms against a huge spectrum of toxic factors. There's also another word for fungi that eats radiation. They are called radiotrophic. As I said before, they are not only resisting the radiation, but they are actually using it to stimulate their growth. We can basically tell today that radiation and melanin are crucial to this, but we can't yet tell how exactly this works. Fungi can be mixing up many different processes like radiosynthesis, photosynthesis or chemosynthesis along the way. So far we only know that they are capable of using the radiation to their benefit, but it will probably take years before we will be able to precisely tell how this happens. But we are getting closer. Since its discovery in 1991, researchers have already patented the method of increasing the melanin content to enhance the whole process. And thanks to their discoveries, they even moved the theory further. They hypothesized that radiosynthesis could have played a huge role in the early development of life on Earth. But here comes the astrofungi. Since 2018, NASA is conducting various experiments, including those on ISS, so International Space Station. They want to check if the rat-munching fungi can act as a barrier during out-of-Earth missions. But since we are talking about using those organisms to our advantage, they could potentially help not only in outer space. Of course, it could take years or even decades before we'll get any actual results, but these fungi are already looked into, for example, as a new food source. And don't imagine them being deep fried in a KFC coating, but researchers are trying to figure out if the fungi could be used as, for example, high altitude biofuel or a nutrition source. One of the other hypothesized uses is cleaning their radioactive waste. You get it, right? People don't like radiation, fungi like radiation. People have radioactive waste, but don't want it, and fungi don't have radioactive waste, but could want it. So, win-win situation. The last idea is especially intriguing, as the mentioned American scientists discovered that those fungi grow a lot in an environment where the radiation level was 500 times higher than normal. Even a short exposure, around 20 to 40 minutes, almost instantly altered the chemical properties of melanin and increased some processes that involve it in those fungi. I only hope that we won't wake up to see some 100 meter tall, walking and talking angry fungi. I mean, come on, Godzilla is enough. As it always is, the nature doesn't like lack of balance. The radiation growing fungi grew slower than its regular cousins when there wasn't any radiation source, or at least when the radiation levels were basically normal. This may also mean that, however, those fungi adapted to living in such a hostile environment, they actually had to pay some price for it. And without the extreme part, they are just less active and they are not as good at getting food from more neutral sources as their other family members. Another interesting fact is that in 2007, one of the scientists looking into our rat-friendly fungi told Scientific American that in various commercial nuclear reactors, the water used in the facility, the radioactive one, becomes contaminated with melanotic organisms with black pigmentation. So, very similar to Chernobyl fungi. Well, if we will use them and feed them with radiation, let's just hope those fungi won't revolt at some point in the future and won't claim some radioactive planet in the nearest neighborhood. That's it for today, guys. I hope you like this kind of popular science videos. We enjoyed making it, so let us know if we should prepare more. Take care and see you next week.